Hello everybody, this is ManuS and welcome back to another Legends of Runeterra spoiler review. I'm here catching up on the latest spoilers, we're almost caught up. Time to look at the first half of the Shadow Isle spoilers with the new mechanic, and then we'll catch up with the new champion Nocturne and the related cards to be on track when the next spoilers roll in, hopefully. Before we do so, you know the drill. Hit the subscribe button down below if you haven't yet. About 70% of my viewers haven't, according to my analytics, so please consider doing so. It takes a few seconds and it really helps the channel grow, and it's free. And now let me briefly introduce you to the sponsor. Today's video is sponsored by NordVPN, one of the leading virtual private network providers out there. A virtual private network keeps your data secure and yourself anonymous while using the internet. NordVPN comes with super fast servers, allows you to unlock your favorite entertainment websites like Netflix. They provide a 30-day money-back guarantee. They also have an included cybersecurity suite, which acts as an ad blocker to boot. They don't lock any of your data, provide a 24/7 customer support, and you can use it on up to 6 simultaneous connections, so one account covers most or all of your electronic devices. And most importantly, they don't have any bandwidth limit, so you can use it non-stop without it getting throttled, which is particularly important for heavy users like us. It also won multiple awards and comes highly recommended by top technology experts. So if you're still surfing online without a VPN, now is the time to change that. Get NordVPN now, 70% off for a 3-year plan, including 1 month extra for free using the code ManuS or the personalized link in the description down below. And now on to today's content. All right, so now that we got that out of the way, let's look at the mechanics. So first off, we have the new keyword associated with Shadow Isles. It's called Nightfall. Nightfall basically means the card gets a bonus if this is not the first card you play in a round. So second, third, and so on. So you ideally want like cheap cards to start your turn off with, so your Nightfall cards do additional things. Nothing too flashy, but might turn out interesting and might change the value of certain cheap cards to make them more appealing as Nightfall enablers, especially cheap burst cards. Like, for example, Sapling Toss in Shadow Isles comes to mind that could benefit from the Nightfall mechanic in being a decent card that was kind of a consideration before, but often kind of didn't quite make the cut. But now, if the Nightfall payoff is big enough, it seems like a good card to enable Nightfall because it costs one and it is burst and it's actually pretty decent. So let's take a look. First off, we have Stygian Onlooker. It's a 1-cost 2/1, so pretty standard on turn one. But with Nightfall, it gets +2/+0 and fearsome this round, so it's a 1-cost 4/1 fearsome for the turn you play it, making it particularly good on defense at trading or on certain boards as a cheap way to deal additional damage. And spend mana to add a 4 attack unit to the board that is attacking that turn and is hard to block can be a really nice tempo swing. So this looks like a decent role player for a more aggressive, fearsome, heavy Shadow Isles deck potentially. But it could also just kind of fall by the wayside because it doesn't really fit in well enough. But I assume they design things in a way to give this a home, so I'm reasonably optimistic on about Onlooker. Yeah, solid role player, really. Nothing flashy, nothing that will make or break a deck, but it will be a certain, like a nice card to fill out a certain proactive strategy. Next we have Doombeast. It's a 3-cost 3/2, and with Nightfall, when you play it, it is a skill, so it goes on the chain. You drain 2 from the enemy nexus. So this is actually like a pretty solid unit if you can enable it, but we're getting a lot of these 3-cost sort of defensive units, like the 3-cost lifesteal toss unit, the Ionia 4/2 lifesteal and stuff, and this is a similar card that is also probably like not terrible in a proactive deck, but probably proactive decks have better options. So this is probably more something for like more defensive mid-range and controlling decks. to sort of, yeah, stabilize health a bit. Although, I mean, it is direct damage, which is nice, but I think all in all, there's too much competition in the 3 cost slot in Shadow Isles alone for this to realistically make it into more proactive decks, but we'll have to wait and see. It's another fine card, nothing too great, I think, but certainly like at a power level where it might show up and construct it here and there in the red decks. Then we have Dusk Rider. It's a 5-cost, 2/5 fearsome. And with Nightfall, it gets +1/+0 for each time you have activated Nightfall this game. So I assume it counts itself, so it's at least a 3/5 fearsome for 5. And let's say you have Nightfall like maybe 2 times before in the game. Makes it a 5/5 fearsome for 5. Honestly, Nightfalling twice isn't even that easy. And a bit of an optimistic assumption, I would say. So if this counts itself, it's probably going to be a 4/5 to a 5/5 fearsome for 5 a lot of the time. And I think anything below a 5/5 fearsome for 5 is probably actually going to be kind of weak. And 5/5 seems fine, but probably not that great. Plus, you need a second card to even trigger the Nightfall for this. So if you can't trigger the Nightfall for this, you end up with a 5-cost 2/5 fearsome, which is really bad. So honestly, I think Dusk Rider looks pretty bad, pretty weak. Card seems kind of underpowered. Maybe it plays a bit better than it looks, but for now, this doesn't make me want to put it into any deck, really. Next, we have Passage Unearned. That's a bit of an odd one. It's a 3-cost fast spell, and you obliterate all units that were summoned but not played this round. So, if I understand this correctly, it obliterates all units that were put into play in a way that is not played from hand. So if I understand this correctly, this, for example, is a 3-cost sort of counter to Harrowing, for example, and other like unit makers or like ways that reset units like Chronicler. So it seems like it's mostly gonna be good against other Shadow Isles units, weirdly enough, and some other fringe synergies. That seems pretty convoluted and very narrow and situational. I don't think this is going to be much of a card. Maybe I'm missing something here. So, yeah. I don't know. Card seems pretty useless, honestly. Not sure what to think of this. Sure, it counts as Harrowing, but... And, like, as some... Okay, fringe situation, situational applications, but I think most of them will be Shadow Isles related, and a lot of them in a lot of decks will just not even have enough targets, so yeah, I think this card sucks. Next we have Encroaching Shadows. It's a 4-cost burst spell, and it grants all allies in deck and hand +2/+2 and ephemeral. Honestly, not a big fan of this card. You can kind of use it as sort of like a finisher setup, like on your non-attack token turn, spend your power to sort of defend and use this, and then on your turn unleash a bunch of like, I don't know, cheap elusives on your opponent or whatever. But basically, all your stuff being ephemeral means you have a really poor defense, especially against open attacks. And +2/+2 is really not that great on units that die at the end of turn, so the opponent can just put their cheapest, smallest units in front of them anyway, and the +2/+2 won't matter, and stuff like that. And you lose out a lot of value. I honestly think, aside from like some very sort of combo-y ways to try and break this, which seems like it's not going to be easy to do, this card's probably pretty bad. I've seen some people hyping it up with elusives or whatnot. But I honestly don't see that being the case. I think it's pretty bad. Like I said, it's very, like, takes away a lot of options. It doesn't add that much. It costs you an entire card. You lose all defense, especially against open attacks. Like, even non-open attacks, if your opponent has a lot of ward and you don't, they can even, like, deploy and you all you can do is play, like, one ephemeral dude to match whatever they already have. So you're not looking particularly hot. And if it would at least say like all, grant all allies everywhere, +2/+2 and ephemeral, would be a bit more interesting, because then you can could pair it with stuff like Haunted Relic and so on. But that isn't even the case, so I don't know. I think this card's probably pretty gimmicky and most likely bad and won't make any major archetypes. So yeah, that concludes all the Shadow Isle spoilers surrounding the new mechanic Nightfall and some cards that aren't actually Nightfall related, but setting up the whole new Shadow Isles, which seems to go into a bit more of a proactive sort of aggro-y direction, which is kind of nice, because I feel like that was something that Shadow Isles was kind of missing. Like, sure, there is Endure, but that deck was mostly a thing because of Endure and not because of like Shadow Isles. Shadow Isles just provided a decent support to feed into Endure, but Shadow Isles standing on its own and as like a proactive strategy has really not been a thing since Shadow Isles has been kind of over-nerfed. I think the nerf to Mark of the Isles was the last nail in the coffin of like true proactive Shadow Isles stuff, and maybe we'll see a resurgence of that, pulling Shadow Isles a bit away from the like late game mid-range control-y stuff with all the 5-cost life gain removal spells and stuff into more of a curve unit focused alternative of playing Shadow Isles, which is kind of cool, and we'll see how Nocturne turns out in the next review video. Alright, that's going to be it again. You know the drill. If you enjoy the content, hit the like button, subscribe to not miss out on more content, check the description for more info, join the Discord, join the conversation over there, and so on. And yeah, that's it again for this time. I'm your host, Manu S, and I thank you for watching.